Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Angela Damiani, and I am the CEO of NEWaukee. Welcome to today's Cloud Cafe presentation of The Shift. Before we get started, I just want to take a moment and thank our series sponsor, Kohler Company, for ensuring the continuity of this really important conversation, even amid these uncertain times. Kohler is a remarkable company doing many things to ensure gender parity in the workplace and beyond. Thank you so much for continuing to support NEWaukee and our mission of changing the way people connect through this new digital universe we're all exploring. In today's shift, we're going to explore the topic of stereotypes that perpetuate the roles we each take on. According to Women in the Workplace report, 81% of women have a partner who works full-time compared to 56% of men. And as employees become more senior, this disparity between women and men grows. 72% of senior level men have a partner who works compared only to 37%. 72% of senior level women have a partner who works compared to only 37% of men at the same level. In other words, men who rise in the workplace are significantly more likely to have a stay-at-home partner than women at the same level. When it comes to household responsibilities, there's also a big gender disparity. 39% of women in dual career relationships report still having to do more or most of the housework compared to just 11% of men. So what are we doing to update our core partnerships to ensure that parity exists beyond the boardroom is really the premise of today's conversation. And I just want to say that all of that seems to have changed now that we're all stuck at home amid COVID. So this was the theme we had in place for today's conversation when we were planning on doing this as an in-person shift. And we decided to move forward and to talk to Colleen Bailey, who's the Vice President and General Manager for Retail Channel of Kohler Company. I think layering in the COVID part of this makes this an even more interesting conversation. And I thank you, Colleen, for joining us here today. I appreciate you joining and being a part of this.
No, thank you, Angela. I really appreciate the opportunity to kind of share my story and to have a discussion with you and the broader audience on this really important topic.
For sure. Well, you guys, Colleen has some thoughts on this topic that she wants to share with us. And then I have some questions for her, but we're hoping after that we'll be able to have some interaction with any of you who are in the Zoom room or on Facebook Live. So without further ado, Colleen, I think I'll tee it over to you and then we can get into the fireside chat following your presentation.
Excellent. Thanks, Angela. And welcome to everyone. Appreciate you taking time out of what I know has got to be a busy and chaotic day for all of you. So when you see this topic, I don't know if any of you kind of had a mental image that came to mind, but I would not be surprised if this looks somewhat similar to sort of how we think about balancing roles and kind of balancing work and home life. But I will tell you, when I first saw the topic, this was not the mental image I had at all. And just wanted to share a little bit more of my story, my background, both professionally and personally. My home life has evolved a lot from having a dual career opposite shift marriage to my husband currently retired and stays at home. And as we fast forward, I have no idea what's next. So I wanted to just kind of share a little bit of my story. I don't purport to be a gender studies expert, but it is a topic that I'm really passionate about. And why am I passionate about it? There's kind of a phrase, right? I'm an only, right? The only woman at the table, the only person of color at the table, the only. And for me, when I have been the only female at the table, primarily at work, it wasn't a place that I liked. It was really lonely. And the experiences I had where I was the only, whether or not that was my first job at the Chicago Board of Trade, I'm going back now almost 30 years, but like running into the trading pit and kind of helping share orders as the only woman at the time that was lonely. When I started in consulting, I was originally in the utilities practice. I'll talk a little bit more about that, but it taught me that while there is power in blazing trails, there's more power, and for me, ultimate happiness in not being the only. So again, I'm really appreciative of the opportunities I've had and that I've created to create networks like women's business resource groups. I'm appreciative of opportunities like this one that Angela's brought forward, and would just really encourage you all, if you're feeling the only, that may be the reality in sort of a certain point in time or a certain circumstance, but it's certainly not the broader reality. And I just encourage you all to kind of continue to build connections and to create forums if they don't exist, to ensure that you are not a lonely only like I have been at times. So I'm going to first get into my professional background, give you a little bit of context, and again, give you a flavor for where kind of gender played a particular role for me. And then I'll talk about my home life. And then we'll get into sort of how this is all changing in a COVID and post-COVID world. So my background, I am not originally from the Milwaukee area. I am from all the way down south in Illinois, which I grew up in the Chicago suburbs, and really thought I was going to be there for forever. I have a very big family, really strong networks. I did all of my schooling in the Chicago area, so went to Northwestern. Terrific experiences there, and then joined Accenture. It was Anderson Consulting at the time, in their strategy practice. And it says here retail strategy practice, but I, as I mentioned earlier, actually started in utilities, and it was not a good experience. I was the youngest person on the team and the only female on the team. And while I loved the work, it was not a good environment. There was definitely kind of uncomfortable situations for me. I really left to go into retail because of that. The retail practice had a reputation at the time. And again, now I'm going back, you know, well over two decades. A lot has changed in that time. But the retail practice had a little bit more gender diversity. And importantly, kind of the word on the street was it was a more family-friendly culture, meaning that more accepting of diversity. There still wasn't a ton of, I didn't see a lot of female role models. And that was ultimately one of the reasons that I decided to leave consulting and go back to business school. But I left to go into retail because of that feeling that I had earlier of being the only in the utilities practice and really wanting to seek out a more accepting environment where I felt like I could be my full self and just focus on the work. I love working. I will probably always love working. And I just didn't like the baggage that came with it, with feeling like I had to apologize for who I was or who I wasn't. And I loved it. The retail strategy practice was a much better home for me. I keep in touch with a lot of the colleagues that I built from there, a lot of incredible leaders that I continue to lead from, both male and female. But again, the culture mattered, and that really kind of shaped my perspective, how important networks were for me in business. So went back actually to business school. I knew that ultimately I did not want to go into consulting for a couple reasons. One was I didn't see a lot of role models that were successfully balancing work and life. And even though I didn't have a boyfriend, let alone a partner, let alone children at the time, or even line of sight to that actually ever happening, I knew that I wanted that in one way, shape, or form, and just wanted something where I wasn't necessarily on the road 80 to 90% of the time. And some of my mentors encouraged me to think about brand management. So long story short, went into that and then went right to Unilever, which was just, it's an incredible company. I don't have more positive things to say about that experience. It was a company who I think was ahead of its time in terms of purpose-driven marketing. I got to be a fly on the wall as some brilliant marketing strategists developed Dove's campaign for Real Beauty. It was a culture that really embraced inclusion without always talking about it, but just the feeling you had. So it was great. And I would probably still be there, but they were going to be moving out of the Midwest. And I'm very tied to the Midwest in many ways. So I decided to start a new career, same field, but work at Conagra. And again, have had really positive experiences there as well. over the 10 years that I was working at Conagra. And really while I was at Conagra, that's when I really started to get involved in things like women's resource groups, helped lead that for many, many years, as well as kind of develop one that was specific when I became a mom during that time, which I'll talk about in a bit, created a moms in business group with my boss at the time, again, trying to make sure that we were building the formal and informal networks and structures to help folks make that transition successfully, both as a mom as well as a professional. So a couple of years ago, I made one of the biggest moves I've ever made. I left the state of Illinois and my family, and we moved up to Kohler to take a position that I'm currently in as vice president and general manager here. So I'm going to now transition to sort of the personal journey, because that move was both driven professionally. Kohler has been a company I've long admired for a long time. This is an industry, the plumbing and design industry is one that has been a personal passion point of mine for a while. But in many ways, that transition was equally part about a big personal change. So during kind of the post-MBA career phase, I married this handsome guy here on the left, James Bailey. There he is in his officer blues. And for most of our marriage, we were dual career opposite shifts, meaning I kind of worked I won't call it 9 to 5, as most of you know, that's not really the reality, but I worked a traditional day shift job that was, you know, primarily during the week overall. And he was a police officer, so he worked a number of different shifts, weekends, weekdays, overnight shifts. And so, there is just a lot of balance and negotiation and discussion that's part of that. And during that time, we also were blessed to have two children. There's Grace, who's now almost 11, and Patrick, who's almost 8 down there. And that was my reality for most of the time, kind of throughout my career trajectory up through sort of the VP level at Conagra. So I have had that experience. But part of the move up here to Wisconsin was this job has a lot more travel, and we were looking for a lifestyle shift because things were working, but we didn't feel like they were great. I was commuting up to 4 hours a day. We weren't seeing each other, and that wasn't in concert with sort of our values. We wanted to spend more time as a family, and when I got the call for the Kohler job, I said, this sounds great, but I don't know how this will ever work because it's not like we're moving to Wisconsin. And James is the one who actually broached the subject of saying, well, what if I retire? What if I stay home? And candidly, you could have probably knocked me over with a feather because that hadn't come up in the 12 years that we had been married prior to that. But James has always been someone who has so many diverse interests. He actually wasn't a cop when I met him. He was a chef when I met him. Before that, he studied acting and lived in California for a long time. So he has always been someone who I think is defined by like a core set of values versus his job. And I think that's one of the things I most admire about him, but he was really open. We talked about it. I continued to advance in the discussions, and here we are living in Wisconsin. He retired from the police force, and he currently stays at home as the full-time caregiver. But we don't know if that's gonna be next. We were in the middle of conversations around, you know, what his next chapter is going to look like. And, you know, just like he's been really supportive and open, I need to meet him there too and continue. Well, I will admit, and we can talk about this in the Q&A, there are many things that are easier having a stay-at-home partner. Last minute customer travel, I have to stress less about finding overnight coverage like I used to. But if he's not 100% fulfilled, then we're not 100% fulfilled. So, you know, I've just got to continue to stay open on that, talk to him about what works and take it from there. But this has been a really unexpected, but really special chapter. And I love this picture in the middle of James and our little guy, Patrick, because in particular, I think Patrick has just like really thrived having this time with James as kind of the always there parent. So now I'll just pivot to a little bit of kind of my learnings in terms of how to address that. Again, we've made a lot of progress in gender equality, not nearly where we need to be, right? But, you know, you've got things like women are now, you know, surpassing men in terms of obtaining college degrees. Women are flocking to, you know, stereotypically male-dominated occupations like law and medicine. High school seniors, you know, are so much more likely today to say that they strongly believe women should have the same opportunities. But gender equality lags for women, especially in the home, right? And married American mothers are spending almost twice as much time on housework and childcare than married fathers. And Angela talked about some of those statistics. And I will tell you, even when James and I were both working together, I never felt that way. I was not in that majority of feeling like I was doing all of it. I think part of it is a partner who's willing to listen and does not have very strong stereotypical notions of gender norms in his mind. He's raised by a really strong single mother. And part of it is we've had to really talk it out, and it's not easy and it's not perfect. But I will tell you that image of sort of the female hand holding up the help sign, it is very rare that I feel that way. And if anything, I feel, especially the last couple of years, more guilt that I should be doing more, because he is taking on the lion's share of some of the you know, traditional work in the home. So the first thing is have a conversation, not the criticism. And I think this is really easy to say, hard to do. But again, whenever we have taken time out, not to kind of nitpick about why you aren't doing something, but to really understand what's important, that has helped us tremendously. We have totally different philosophies on what like a home should look and feel like. He is, he doesn't like to go to bed without, you know, all the dishes put away in the sink. And candidly, if that gives me another hour to like talk with the kids or go for a walk, or like I have a really strong ability to shut out the clutter mentally. I prefer a clean home. I like it, but I'm not one to wake up in the middle of the night stressing about the dishes not being done. I am sure that they will get there in the morning, and I will 80% of the time get them done in the morning, and sometimes they'll still be there a little later. So we have different norms, but again, understanding and discussing that has been really helpful. Whereas there's other things that are super, super important to me and less important to him. So again, it shouldn't be about criticizing why things aren't getting done, but how do you really have the conversation on what that looks like? Again, another thing that we were on the same page at is spending time with the kids and making sure that they're happy, is that is a value we both really hold. So again, kind of protecting their time, making sure if what makes them happy is being in sports, we find a way to kind of get them to that and make time for that. Because that is a priority for us above pretty much all else. This is another important one, and I love this saying. So I see so many friends and colleagues kind of struggle with this, right? Like, I would let my husband do it, but he just doesn't know the right way to do the laundry, or he just doesn't know that. And I just fundamentally don't agree with that, to be totally candid. I think that is almost arrogant in assuming that. Things may happen a different way. And I've been on the receiving end of that too. Like, I definitely don't do things exactly the same way that my husband does. He's very methodical in his cleaning, and I'm a little bit more, you know, easily distracted. So it will take me longer, but they both get done the same way. And I think you gotta get comfortable that different people have different ways of doing things. You certainly would not be that way at work as a strong manager, right? You would not micromanage, because you understand and you see how that ultimately holds you back. And I think perfectionism in the home is also a refusal to let yourself move ahead and be happy, quite frankly. So I think this is a big one, and I think a mindset shift. And again, you can say it, but you've got to feel this. But I, you know, in some ways, when people ask me like, how come you're not stressed about everything you have to get done at home? I think honestly, this tendency is sort of a grace I give myself that makes me happier. And again, whenever, you know, James and I are having conversations, we do talk about like, yes, we do have different ways of doing things, and maybe one is preferred, but that doesn't make it absolutely right. So then COVID happened, right? And we were talking with Angela about, okay, are we still doing this? We're still doing this. And the topic honestly couldn't be more relevant, right? Because how does this all change with COVID? I mean, it changes a lot, right? We are all home all the time. We've never spent this much time together. And it's been really good. Like, of course we have our, you know, crazy moments, and my neighbors will attest to that. Like, I will have my crazy moments where it's all a little bit too much, but on the whole, it's been good. And I think because foundationally, we've talked through a lot of this stuff before. And again, kind of the big thing too is, just because something's important to you doesn't mean it's important to someone else, even if it's your life partner, right? And just people are more likely to do things that they value, right? So assign those chores accordingly. I don't necessarily value getting the dishes done before I go to bed, but I sure as heck value laundry. Like, I really, for whatever reason, that one's more important to me. I sure as heck value, you know, making sure that, you know, the dogs are fed and the dogs are walked. Like, those are things that I value. I value yard work more than my husband does. Like, so even though that may be stereotypically more of sort of, you know, male work versus female work, which a notion I kind of reject, I value it more, therefore I should do it. So I think sometimes people say, you know, I need to do this because I'm better at doing it. And again, that's a value judgment. That's not an absolute judgment, but you can say, what is really important to me? When do I feel fulfilled and satisfied? And then try and do that accordingly. So again, for me, as I think about my kids' schoolwork, I really value reading. I value that reading unlocks the mind. I think it fuels the soul. So like, I am happy to be in charge of making sure that they've got their reading time, and I will curl up with a book next to them because that is value. I personally do not value learning cursive writing. So when my son is asked to work on writing cursive, I quite frankly don't value there. Therefore, like, don't put me in charge of making sure if Patrick does his cursive writing, because I won't, because I don't value it. So again, that's maybe just another mindset to think about. How do you divide and conquer a little bit? Because then those chores won't feel perhaps quite so burdensome. And kind of, again, final thought, and again, we'll have much more of kind of an open dialogue. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the work of Gretchen Rubin. She wrote The Happiness Project, but again, I'm a reader and I'm a researcher by nature, right? So as I was, you know, diving into this topic, I originally kind of approached it almost academically, and I just didn't think that was going to be quite as valuable. But, you know, when I asked her, you know, I just Googled, you know, gender norms in the time of COVID, and Gretchen's blog popped up, and I'd really encourage you all to kind of take a deeper dive into that. I think she's got just a lot of good pragmatic advice. But again, you know, first of all, this is an unprecedented time, right? Everyone's more anxious, everyone's more fearful. And for like, different people approach that different ways. And for some folks, they are at a tipping point. And that's a time to first and foremost remember love. And I think that's really important, as again, we're talking about you know, gender roles and rethinking that in the time of COVID. And this may be a time in particular where if you could overlook a neglected chore, maybe this is the time. Maybe folks don't need that one more criticism or that one more comment. Maybe we just all need a little bit of a breather. But on the flip side, if I can perform that chore that I think is pointless and necessary, but it's actually taking some burden off James, maybe I should do it. Maybe I should teach Patrick cursive. Not because I think the chore is important, but because I think the output of giving James that extra half hour to decompress is what he needs and what then, you know, we need as a family. And maybe this is the time also just again to let things go that would bother us and kind of really again kind of go back to the core that, you know, this is unprecedented, anxious time. But if you can kind of start from a place of understanding and grace and love, I think hopefully that'll make that anxiety and fear a little bit more bearable. And again, maybe even give you some tools as we kind of re-enter kind of the new normal that'll help folks feel a little bit more balanced and at peace with sort of the behavior at home. So again, you know, I don't think that gender division of the housework is going to be made equal by women just deciding to do less. I don't think that's it, but it's around how do we, you know, where folks have that experience or feeling that men aren't doing more, you know, how do they do that? And again, acknowledge that the small moments matter. When you see something, how do you make sure that you're encouraging it as opposed to discouraging it, either overtly or innately by saying, you know, that's not the way I would do that. But, you know, those daily habits matter. You can only change yourself. You can't change others. And how do you make sure that you kind of are doing your best to lead to larger patterns of equality, not just in the workplace, but at home as well.
Thank you so much, Colleen. I agree with you in so many different ways. I'm so excited to get into a little bit more detail here with you. I just want to reiterate that this can be an open dialogue for the folks who are signed in. Feel free to use the chat to ask your own questions. We'll be monitoring that, but I'm going to jump in and ask you, so I hear you in that maintaining your core partnership with your husband and you know, ensure in terms of trying to ensure parity or at least the idea that there's a sense of fairness between you requires a heavy amount of communication. That seems sort of basic, but I think a lot of times, particularly, you know, in the early stages of a relationship, you may have when you're dating like a lot of us conversations, like where are we going? What do we want? You know, you sort of like paint the future vision out loud in the air. And then the like rubber kind of hits the road once you get married. Like you get busy, ideally your careers are accelerating. It's incredibly distracting to have tiny humans completely invade your homes and your lives. How often do you and James feel like you're having these sorts of us conversations where you're addressing the things that maybe are irksome to you or, you know, making a plan for how you want to evolve into the next stage of your life?
I mean, pretty frequently. The big transition from going from dual career to, you know, James staying at home, that was a massive conversation because we were uprooting our whole lives. And I think I'm grateful for that in many ways because I don't know that we would have necessarily carved that out. I think before that, sometimes things had to hit like a bit of a boiling point and then we would talk about it as opposed to kind of this full reset just gave us a lot of time to kind of talk through it. But we still have those conversations all the time. And when we had a good conversation this morning, again, the dishes is clearly front of mind because James cooked, typically I do the dishes and I will do 80% of the dishes at night and then let the big one soak. And then usually I'm up by like five. So usually I get like the last of the dishes done like between right. 5 minutes, right? And today I didn't. And James is like, you know, he wakes up maybe, you know, 8-ish. And so we had a conversation around 8:15. He's like, it really frustrates me that you didn't get this done. And then, but instead of like attacking, he's like, and why he'll have a conversation. He's like, and what really frustrates me is not that you didn't do it. It's that you promised that you would and you didn't. And so like, he kind of takes it to that next level. So it doesn't feel like we're bickering. It feels like we're talking. And so I think that's a muscle that we're building, but.
And I think it's necessary for a healthy relationship because you're not the person you each were when you met, right? Like you're constantly evolving and growing. And I think what's important for core partnership is that you evolve and grow in the same direction, but that can't happen without like feedback and iteration and knowing that like we're all fallible human beings. And like maybe last night you were just tired, right? Like you wanted to be done doing chores. That is what it is. I think the other piece of it too is like not taking everything so personally. So my husband is also named James. He also needs the sink to be clear. So I was a little bit laughing about our situations are the same in that way. And I think, you know, part of it is the thing we've been talking a lot, especially in the quarantine, is, you know, not assuming that something's being left undone and the fact that it's left undone is like an attack on your preferences, right? Like perhaps there's just like, let's assume that everyone's doing the best they possibly can and that there's no offensive, overt like, you know, I'm trying to do this to piss you off. If we can lift out of that, I think it can help to have a more productive, like, I need to bring this, you know, to light so that you're aware of it, so that we can more comfortably sort of navigate this quarantine mayhem.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, though, just because you've had such an accelerated professional career, have there been times when your own idea about your gender has been in conflict with the reality of your work or your family responsibilities? Like, and what I mean by that is, like, you know, you guys decided consciously you were going to have a dual career household, you were going to split up the chores, you were going to figure out how to navigate the travel. But have there been moments where, even though you consciously decided that, you maybe also had some assumptions about what it means to be a good wife, what it means to be a good mom, and there's been some, like, something you've had to navigate internally?
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's been more on the motherhood side versus the wife side, candidly. And I think, you know, I've got a twin sister who stays at home full-time with her kids. You know, I grew up where my mom stayed at home with us until high school. And so part of that is like a lot of conflict. Am I a good enough mother? And like, there are moments like, you know, our neighborhood group chat is, it's all the moms plus James. And like, because he's the one who like is there for the play dates and everything. And sometimes I feel like I put pressure on myself, like, oh, I wish I was as good as, you know, I should be on that texting exclusively. I should be doing all of that myself. Cause you know, some of the other moms, they work too, but their husbands aren't on there. But again, it's, so yeah, that's where I definitely feel tension and struggle sometimes. And honestly, I talk to my kids about it too. And I'm like, you know, how do you feel about this? And it's my daughter that makes me usually like, pulls me out of it. She's in fifth grade. She's a wise old soul. And she's like, just because some of the moms are there all the time doesn't mean that they're like really there, you know? And so she kind of stamps me back a little bit. And yeah, so she plays that role, honestly, sometimes more than others, of kind of snapping me back and helping me realize, I'm still a great mother. She, you know, I hope she's not hearing and we'll zoom in and be like, actually she's not. But we're really, really, really close. And I think, you know, that to me helps me feel better about some of the trade-offs that I've, you know, that I made. Cause I'm not here when I'm traveling a little bit more, I'm not there for every single thing, but I just try and do the best that I can. And when I'm here, I really try and make sure that I'm here. So.
For sure. Yeah. I've been the, my husband's been the primary caregiver since our son was born 2.5 years ago. And now we have another little baby as well. And there've definitely been moments, actually it's been more with my girlfriends where we're out, you know, no, it's not that often, but getting a glass of wine or something. And, you know, they each lament whatever stage of development their children are. And they know in particular detail, you know, when things started, but, and I can't recall, I wasn't there. You know what I mean? At home, I don't exactly know when, you know, he first started rolling from front to back. And I find I have a bit of a shame, I guess, about like not knowing those milestones. But on the other side of it, you know, the first time I saw him roll over was the first time I saw him roll over. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, does it really matter if it was the first time it ever happened? It was still new and exciting. You know what I mean? And something that we were able to experience. And I was given some advice by a mother who owns her own business during my first pregnancy. And she said, you know, your kids only know what they know. Whatever's happening in your household is what's normal for them. You know what I mean? Like they don't know what's happening in other households. So this idea that you have to, whatever you scorecard you're holding yourself up to, they don't have that in their head. That's in your head. And so, you know, I think what you said so poignantly about providing yourself some grace is something I'm constantly reminding myself of. So how do I just be more graceful with the fact that there's no sort of like, you know, finish line here where we're all going to be like scored on what type of parents we were. Someone in the chat asked, do conversations ever come up with your husband that he sacrificed his career for you in making this transition? And does that, you know what I mean? How do you work through a conversation like that?
Yeah, I mean, it definitely does. I think it helped that it was, he was the one who first brought that up about retiring. So I think that helps. But that's why, you know, that slide, I was really clear. This may not be the permanent solution for our family because, you know, there is a lot that he misses. He was excellent at his job. He was a police officer and, you know, got commendations, great with the community. And so, that conversation does come up, and that's when I have to remind myself, even though, you know, this may be, you know, my preferred way of kind of splitting things, it doesn't mean it's the permanent solution for us, right? So it does. And I think just making sure we I listen to that. I think there are other things about his career that fulfilled him that he can still find ways. So he's very creative. So he's been working on some screenplays and just making sure that I'm respectful of making sure he's carving out time for that. And, you know, that's something I try and always be mindful of too. It's never perfect, but again, yeah, that conversation absolutely comes up and, again, try and make sure we're just talking through, okay, what is it about that? Because again, there were parts of his job that weren't always perfect and that he doesn't miss, but there are things like male camaraderie, like he misses, you know, he grew up with brothers, the police force is very, very, you know, strong sense of camaraderie. Well, it's important for me to give him time to find that camaraderie in other ways, right? And to have him respect that time.
For sure. You mentioned that you think part of the reason why, maybe some of the stereotypical gender assignments aren't in the case is because James was raised by a strong single mother. Given that you guys are, you know, in partnership raising your children and you have a dual gender set of kids, I'm wondering, do you find yourself raising your kids differently or according to their genders in certain ways? Are you conscious at all about your son, watching the dynamism of your partnership and, you know what I mean, perhaps not leaning into that, breeding some sort of stereotypes in the future?
Yeah, I think it's probably happening more like beneath the surface. We don't have a lot of deep conversations yet, but I think he observes different things. I think it's funny, you know, if I have to explain, you know, Patrick, he's in second grade. He's like so typical little boy, you know, like he loves sports and he wakes up and asks Alexa like what the scores are when they were still playing. Like, so he is, he loves baseball, basketball, football, like really, he's very athletic. And Grace is very into, you know, fashion and trends and style and math and books. And so I don't think I try and overcorrect that either. Like if, you know, Grace honestly would have very little interest in doing anything other than like wearing all pink. Like she just, you know, she embraces that. And Patrick is, you know, kind of all boy, but in just in terms of their interests. But again, in terms of like when I ask him, you know, what do you think about mom working? He's just like, well, you're good at it and you like it. So of course you work, you know? So I think it's just it's almost more not trying to embed past stereotypes because I don't think they're today's future stereotypes.
Agreed, yeah. So. It is funny though, because we had a little boy first and I was very particular about like, he's only gonna wear gender neutral colors. He's gonna wear gray and white. I'm not gonna push the truck theme, yeah. You know what I mean? Like yeah. Really, really intentional. And then we had a girl 4 months ago and I feel like I'm like pink on pink on pink, pink. Like it's like completely different. Like the way I'm treating the little girl, like somehow I was like, oh, I forgot about ribbons. Ribbons are amazing. Can we change her in a day? So it's interesting how it's been different for me, at least in their, like, they're both so tiny now.
Yeah.
It's mostly about the clothes that they wear, but it'll be interesting to see how it evolves over time because their dad will have been a stay-at-home dad for their majority of their like littleness. Someone asked in the chat, the hot topic conversation with my partnership is things like networking and speaking events, which are both optional but full of potential. How do you prioritize going to events like those while giving time and attention to your partner and family?
You know, I don't say yes to everything for sure. Like I'm in a customer facing role now, so I could probably be at customer dinners and networking events 4 or 5 nights a week in a normal circumstance. So I'm pretty choiceful about what I will say yes to, and just making sure, for me, I value more where I'm going to be like an active participant and have like good conversations versus something that I could just sort of absorb. I think I also, you know, we have different time clocks here too. So like for me, I try and do whatever I can. I wake up super early because I just like to. So I try and cram in as much as I can before then. So I'm much more likely to say yes to a networking coffee than I am to a networking dinner. Always have been, always will be, because I feel like I'm not taking away from other things at that time. Whereas, you know, networking dinner, that's tougher. Like it has to be pretty exceptional. So, and for me, I guess I always value depth over breadth in terms of networking too. So for me, it's not necessarily about how many events I'm going to, but am I actually having good conversations? Am I making good connections there?
For sure. What, you sort of talked about like being the only back in the day, I guess. What advice do you have for other young women starting out their careers now, knowing that the world has changed and the threshold for certain behaviors is no longer acceptable?
Yeah, I in some ways, God, this makes me sound older than I want to, but like I'm envious of that. Like, honestly, I wish I had had a little bit more confidence when I was right out of my 20s, knowing that some of that behavior, I mean, there was some pretty egregious behavior that is clearly not just like, unacceptable, but illegal that I tolerated, and I tolerated it. And I wish I had just had more confidence back then, but it wasn't talked about as overtly, and I felt really isolated. So I guess, you know, again, the advice would be you're not the only. If you feel like you're the only, like, get outside that circumstance and find others. You will find that support network, and that will help you. That's how I address that.
For sure. Well, I am just checking the comment box to see if there's any other questions. If there's a last one, please let us know. But I really appreciate, Colleen, you taking the time to connect with us, especially now amid how many things you're balancing working from home. We did have one more pop through. If you don't mind, this will be our last question for the afternoon. But how can we start and encourage conversations within our workplaces, especially with those struggling around inclusion and diversity? You sort of talked about in your past being a part of forming female ERGs and things of that sort. If a company doesn't already have that and someone feels motivated to do it, where do they begin?
So at Kohler, I actually helped to charter that. And I'd been part of existing ERGs before. Really, I would start with like just doing some online research, connect. Like if you don't have one and you're interested, reach out to me. You'll have my contact information. But again, there's not really a playbook. You just have to find others who did it and try, and then build from there. And again, the women in Women Network group that we've got is continues to evolve, and we're adding new things and listening to the members on what they need. So I think that's a place to start. I think your human resources team is a good place to kind of ask, you know, is there organizational appetite for this? I was really fortunate that there was huge organizational appetite to get that going at Kohler. Very, very supportive of sort of advancing the diversity and inclusion workplace. They just didn't yet have the structure, you know, going back almost 3 years ago, and now that structure's in place. So again, I would reach out. I think, there's a couple online resources that are pretty helpful too. Catalyst.org is one that I go to a lot as I was trying to figure out how do you structure this. Reaching out to other employee groups that, you know, perhaps a women's employee network group doesn't exist, but other ones do. Those partners have been really helpful connections for me over time to kind of learn what's working and not. And again, it doesn't necessarily have to be a formal employee resource group or ERG to have the conversation. I think I've all just finding other people and picking up on conversations and discussing, It can start really, really small. The moms and business group I had been part of at Conagra honestly just started, I was pregnant with my first, my boss was pregnant with her third, and we realized there was just, I had such an advantage because I had a wealth of information that I could ask. Like my boss knew everything there was to know about, like, how do you make sure that you've got a smooth transition? How do you on-ramp? How do you off-ramp? Like, how do I understand the benefits? So knowing that was an advantage and some of my friends didn't have that, like, how do you formalize that? But that really just started with kind of a couple people who really cared about it, and it kind of can bloom from there. So I guess the advice is don't get intimidated that it has to be formal to start. Just see if you can find a couple other folks with similar interests, and then you can kind of work concurrently to see if a more formal structure, you know, is ultimately the right thing for you and your organization.
For sure. Thank you for that. I really appreciate it. And I'll just shamelessly plug an outgrowth of this shift series is actually an organization called the Rev Collective that Kohler is actually a major sponsor of as well. And in that, we consciously curate groups of 6 to 8 women who have similar professional and personal aspirations. And we train them on an accountability practice that allows them to be radically vulnerable with one another and actually achieve their dreams. And so I encourage you guys to check out revcollective.com if you'd like more information or you'd like to join one of those groups. It can be incredibly helpful getting sort of that outside perspective and resources to bring some new ideas back to your workplace. Colleen, thank you so much for giving us your time this afternoon and for being so candid with us about your own personal and professional journey. We really appreciate it. There's more on the docket for NEWaukee's Cloud Cafe this week. I encourage you to check out NEWaukee.com to see what is upcoming, and we hope that you tune in soon. Take care, everyone. Stay safe. Bye.